All right. Let's give her a hand on that. Very good, Katie. Thank you. Good job. You too, Runa. Good to see you. Good to see you here all. It's another bright day. This time, instead of parking out there it directly into the sun, I parked over there so it didn't make me sneeze like it did last Sunday. I was going crazy. Beautiful day. Jim, you has some good news, it sounds like. He'd like to share that with everyone. There we go. Sure.
Well, I'm pleased to report that your Met Committee, you all know who we all are and you help us out, has completed the ministry site program.
Yes.
And, hopefully, with the help of perhaps Tom or somebody else, we need to send it now. We've been working so hard on getting it done, how to get it there, and find a way to do it. Something over the weekend.
Yes, yes. Every little bit, yes. Good job getting it done. Yes, thanks to the Met team and all that work that goes into it. Yes. Anyone else? This is a beautiful day. We're in the season of within Lent. For all able, please rise. The glory of these 40 days. A beautiful Sunday morning, I say to you, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship and renewal of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
We pray. Lord God, our strength, the struggle between good and evil rages within and around us, and the devil and all the forces that defy you tempt us with empty promises. Keep us steadfast in your word, and when we fall, raise us again and restore us through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Maybe we turn to the word.
The first lesson is Psalm 32. Happy are those whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Happy are those to whom the Lord imputes no iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no deceit. While I kept silent, my body wasted away through my groaning all day long. For day and night your hand was heavy upon me. My strength was dried up as by the heat of summer. Then I acknowledged my sin to you, and I did not hide my iniquity. And I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the guilt of my sin. Therefore, let all who are faithful offer prayer to you. At a time of distress, the rush of mighty waters shall not reach them. You are a hiding place for me. You preserve me from trouble. You surround me with the glad cries of deliverance. I will instruct you and teach you the way you should go. I will counsel you with my eyes upon you. Do not be like a horse or a mule without understanding, whose temper must be curbed with a bit and bridle, else it will not stay near you. Many are the torments of the wicked, but steadfast love surrounds those who trust in the Lord. Be glad in the Lord and rejoice, O righteous, and shout for joy, all you upright in heart. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The gospel reading is from the fourth chapter of Matthew, starting with the first verse. Then Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. He fasted for 40 days and 40 nights, and afterwards he was famished. The tempter came and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread." But he answered, "It is written, one does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God." Then the devil took him to the holy city and placed him on the pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and on their hands they will bear you up so that you will not dash your foot against a stone." Jesus said to him, "Again, it is written, do not put the Lord your God to the test." Again, the devil took him up to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. And he said to him, "All these I will give you if you will fall down and worship me." Jesus said to him, "Away with you, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve only him." Then the devil left him, and suddenly angels came and waited on him. The word of the Lord.
And Jesus fasted for how many days? 40. Well, Aaron Rodgers has nothing on Jesus. Isn't that what he's kind of been doing? He just got back from his 3 or 4 days of silence. And let's pray. Lord God, we thank you that, as Psalmist reminds, you counsel us, you keep your eye upon us, and that you remind us not to be like horses or mules without understanding, whose temper flares at what they don't like to hear. Bless us now as we meditate upon a very important topic, as your word reminds. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, grace and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Temptations, major theme of the gospel, a major theme of scripture. It's story upon story of God's people, how they've been tempted to do something which God didn't enjoy or appreciate or thought was right, and they did it anyway. So temptation, it's not just about Jesus, but how many times again was Jesus tempted? Three times, at least here in the scripture. When's the last time you've been tempted? Seven deadly sins is greed, sloth or laziness, not willing to work. Lust, gluttony, eating more than we really need, wanting more than we really need, wrath, anger, which gets just unhelpful, envy, and then the last one is pride, Pride, in which theologians remind in Scripture, it shows that pride is really the foundational one, which a lot of other sins and brokenness comes out of when we're so prideful. But temptation can come in a variety of other ways. For instance, a 20-year-old student, and I kind of relate to this. I got into my junior year. I didn't know what I wanted to do with a major, etc. I broke up with my longtime girlfriend, and I was in agony the fall of my junior year. And that's when I decided to go into the military during the Vietnam War. I wasn't drafted, and everybody thought I was crazy. But anyway, this young gentleman was confused about life because he couldn't decide. So he got the idea, I'm going to open up the Bible, and maybe it'll give me some encouragement, etc. So he turned to Matthew 27:5, and it said, "And Judas went and hanged himself." That was kind of eye-opening, confusing. So he opened Luke 10:37. Jesus said, "Go and do likewise." So he's just flipping like that, thinking that's going to give him some inspiration. And finally, the third time, John 13:27. Jesus said, "Go and do quickly what you're going to do." Ooh. He took the Bible and put it back in his bookshelf and didn't turn to it for a long time. There's a temptation to choose things, in other words, that we think sometimes magically is going to help us without doing the necessary due diligence and processes of coming to terms with what is my life, what do I want to choose in my vocation, where do I want to go in my life, etc., etc. Like Scripture says, again, Proverbs 4:7 is, "Get wisdom, and above all, get insight." The temptation is, no, I know everything, or I know about every situation. I don't need to research more. That can be a temptation when we need to be more researching. Matthew 7:7, "Ask and it will be given. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be open." Not instantly, not magically like the temptation. Well, Jesus said, I just got to do a little seeking and asking and knocking. It's often a longer discipline process. But the temptation is, I want it now. And so sometimes those temptations are very real. Temptation of Jesus was, in general, a summary of the three was to manipulate God, to make things easier. That's the temptation from the devil, was, hey, you are. Let's see what the first one was. If you are the Son of God, command the stones to become loaves of bread. And Jesus responds, no, there's more to life than just bread is necessary for our physical needs, but there's more to life, the bread of our Heavenly Father through His Word. And I need to take time and digest that. Second, throw yourself down from the pinnacle temple, and God will protect you. The devil was testing him. Do Christians ever test God? God, if you'll take this pain in my life away, I'll go to church every Sunday from now on out. I'll give more. I'll serve more. There's a testing that goes on. If I get better, God. Third, worship me, evil says, and receive the things that you desire. And Jesus says, look, you're not supposed to have other gods before our Heavenly Father and all that He wants for us. Temptations are great. Jesus experienced them, and we need to be serious about them. But it's hard to be a follower of Christ in a world with a lot of strong voices out there about what's right, what's wrong, about a lot of situations. You can go online now and find anybody spouting off. It's incredible on YouTube and Rumble, wherever. There's so many voices who are always sharing things, and it can be confusing, particularly if we want to be serious about following Jesus. How do they match up? It'd be easier just to listen to what this person says. It's interesting that Jesus often would respond to the temptations with what words? It is written. What is written in Scripture is part of that process of helping us grow better to deal with temptation. And what is written today can be positive or greatly negative. So now, as I often do, one hand on the Bible, as I always taught in sermon 40-some years ago, and one on the newspapers, you need application. So I'm bringing my application, which I think is a necessary thing to talk about in our day and age when writing and how it's presented is at times pretty negative. And I'll intro to it. My nurse daughter, who's 43, vet hospital, she's in the hospice unit. That's whatever she worked for. She's 20, early 22 years now. So she got where she wanted to move. She's very gifted. But she floored me a couple years back when we got talking. She loves to have father-daughter talks and call me up out of the blue. You know, to Dad, I don't know, we must have been talking about the topic about some of the trends in society. You know, Dad, when I graduated from Franklin, I hated America. Erica, what do you mean he hated America? Well, Dad, you should hear the things that we learned in our history books and social studies about America. It's detestable. That floored me. And now, as part of my ongoing, I have more degrees than I need for the et cetera, because I've always been a person who's often seeking and asking and knocking and not just accepting the presentation. But maybe that's one of the variables is what's being taught in schools to come up with some of the stuff that is now the realities. There's also parenting. There's also other peer pressure. Because this is what we find, Morning Consult and Pew Research, major, you know, polling and research and all that stuff have come up. It says millennials now, age 26 to 42, only 36% of millennials, 26 to 42, are proud to live in America. Is that real positive? 36. Generation Z, ages 13 to 25, only 16% feel proud to live in America. Why is that? I had a more positive, maybe not 100%, when I got out of high school. But then here's another one for churches who are concerned about how do you bring in youth. Listen to what they say about this. Millennials, 26 to 42, 45% want nothing to do with church. There's no religious affiliation. 45%. Generation Z, no religious affiliation, 49%. Does that sound like an easy task then to say, oh, hey, welcome to church? Yeah, right. Yeah, what do you got to offer me? There's some challenging times and trends. So what I is often in, like in a counseling with couples, counseling with individuals, you always have these questions that you have in your mind to flesh out what's going on. Where did you get the idea? So finally, after 42 years in ministry ordained, I researched, particularly after Erica said what she said and it floored me, I found out a guy by the name of Howard Zinn. Anybody ever heard that name? Did you know that in 1980, his book became the one basic history book in our school systems, high school, college, et cetera, et cetera. He wrote this, A People's History of the United States. It is the number one textbook for every level of education. Oh, there will be some who offer other things, but it is this. And there are numerous critics, and I am critical of that too, because of some of the approach that he took to presenting to our children over the 1980, still in, and he's still buying, they're buying his books incredibly a lot at all levels of education. Because what I'm presenting is Zinn, I believe, fell to the temptation that is very dangerous for country and church and Christianity. Because he admits in his book that he's a political activist and he's a socialist. You know what a socialist is? Someone who believes that basically a lot of tenets of Marx and Lenin can apply here, and we haven't tried it enough so that we could be a socialist country. That is very strong in certain groups. So he unapologetically is a partisan for socialism. And this is what he opens his people history with, that people forget or don't read. By the time I began teaching and writing, I had no illusions about objectivity. If that meant avoiding a point of view, I knew that as a historian or journalist or anyone telling a story was forced to choose out of an infinite number of facts what to present and what to admit. And that decision inevitably would reflect, consciously or not, the interest of the historian. He died in 2010. He was a socialist who had all sorts of negative things to say about our country in his history book that our decade after decade, our youth have been reading. For instance, in his People's History, he has little positive to say about religion and Christianity. Nothing. In fact, when he was teaching in a college, he said that a college chapel, you know, the weekly chapel at least once a week, is nothing more than a meaningless ritual. Christianity is a villainous oppressor, a genocidal tyrant towards peaceful indigenous people. And if you can see the illustrations, but he doesn't talk about religion that much in Christianity. In amongst 700 and some pages, it's really a wide book. Because the indifference, he blames Christianity for racism, enslavement, and segregation of African Americans. Because, of course, you can find in it's written in Scripture that, you know, be kind to your slaves, right? So certain people, groups over the years have taken that and unduly oppressed their slaves, had slaves. Of course there was that abuse. But a preponderance of Christians didn't agree. He says a lot about capitalism. Does he like it? No. It's all evil. You are a capitalist if you want to have make your own money and want to keep it to you. It needs to be shared equally with others. Equity, it's now called. And if you don't want to share, the government has the right to take it from you. There's a lot of stuff, and this is, I'm just giving you some of the et cetera, et cetera. Do you wonder why then with all the dissing of America, capitalism, because it's oppressive, et cetera, to anybody different or the minorities. And what he does is he focuses on a lot of the negative, and that caps it. He gives a lot of individual stories, which are horrific, but he downplays all the positive that came out of it. Wonder why then that our younger generations detest America and Christianity? That's been the major historical book since 1980 in our country, and it still is. It's going strong. Now, you might say, really? Well, okay, I've done tons of marital counseling. For instance, if a couple came to me, and I've had some, very angry couples coming, and do you think it would be right for me as a therapist over the years to say, okay, I'd like to know what's going on. What would you share? And if I didn't set any boundaries, and both individuals in that marital relationship, I allowed them to do was, He never. She never. And I've had some doozies who've said that. And just no boundaries. Just, oh yeah, just keep sharing. Never. Negative. He doesn't do this. She doesn't do this. Blah, 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 blah. In therapy, does that allowing that to take place, you want to hear some of the stuff like that. But that you also, good therapy goes, but what did you like about this person when he got married? How does that person still do that? No, I want to talk about how bad he is. Good therapists don't allow that to happen because it doesn't allow what? A foundation to improve in a relationship and move to healing in a relationship. What Zen has done is just offered negative bombarding upon bombardment of Christians, of capitalism. Anything positive, it's all bad. And it needs to be changed. It all needs to be changed. Have you heard any of that? We're going to have the great reset when we're going to run the country like it should be. Good luck on that one. Are you going to get enough people to get behind you when all you've done is says you white people are the cause of every dang bad thing in America? Racism, prejudice. That's being said out there, folks. I can give you all sorts of illustrations, and if you want to ask me, I'll show you some of them. So I prefer the historians. There's many historians who say what he's done is abuse the system. He's offered his opinion because he's trying to get people to think his way without offering facts on both sides and data. Michael Medved, I didn't encourage. He's an honors from Yale. He was in the same college as Hillary who? Clinton. They were in college together. They knew each other. Michael was on the left side of the spectrum, but he wrote a book about right turns where he saw enough where he started going middle right. Right turns. He writes in 2008 a book called The 10 Big Lies About America, Combating Destructive Distortions About Our Nations. Number one, America founded in genocide against Native Americans. That's all their intent was. To wipe out the natives. That's the main intent. That's a major lie. Two, U.S. is uniquely guilty for the crime of slavery. Three, founders intended a secular, not a Christian nation. Those are big lines that he goes into. And he gives a balanced. Yes, Americans have done terrible things to the indigenous, to a number of people, to each other over the years, but he's a good therapist when he says, yes, that's happened, but what are the positives? He does critical thinking instead of teaching ideology, which Zinn does. Number two, the lie that America was the sole major thing of racism in the world, and I'll quote this. As grotesque and utterly unjustifiable as the institution of slavery was, it was not peculiar to the West or to America. Slavery has been going on for ages, country after country. Whenever they've battled, whenever they wanted slaves, they took them. Even a good old Viking, I'm from Scandinavia. What did the Vikings do to people? Oh, they did horrible things. They'd rampage and then they'd bring people home to slaves. The Native Americans have a strong history of that. Other historians tell us that. They can be wonderful in certain ways, but they also did some of the negative stuff, that et cetera, et cetera. And he goes on to this. It has existed throughout all human history on all continents. In fact, it still exists in parts of Africa today, and slavery is still taking place. In fact, there's a thing called the slave trade by the sex what? Traffic that's going on worldwide. It's really a slavery. Taking young kids, women, men, and offering them across the world as sexual objects. It's still taking place. However, Britain and America, with help from no one else, were responsible for bringing it to an end in the West. There need to be no ongoing apologies for slavery, as some of the left have falsely claimed, but shows how Western Christian values were central in ridding most of the world of this plague. It was Christian clergy, both in England and America, who worked hard first in the north of our country and then helped bring out. And then that the guy who wrote Amazing Grace, part of his background is all about that. He's a clergy person who was a slave trader who then said that found out it was wrong, and he worked worldwide to bring it in the major countries to an end, etc. There's a temptation, in other words, to have false news, fake news if you want, to try to persuade people to their way of opinion. That's why when Christ answered the temptation with, "It is written," it's important to understand what's being written and who writes it. "It is written," Christ said. To fight the good fight, we need to know what's in Scripture. And Scripture strongly tells us that God's people were ornery people time and time again. That was the story all the way through, and that's the battle. But God says, okay, because you've done it once or ahead of series, I'm going to ban you to hell. None of that. Each day is a new day of forgiveness. Now get your act together. There's renewal. I'm going to close with this. In Death Valley, there's a place known as Dante's View. You can look down at this spot to the lowest point in the United States. If you get to this spot, down to a depression 200 feet below sea level. And the sea level is called bad water. It's not a nice place to be around. But from Dante's View, you can also look up to the highest peak in the United States, which is Mount Whitney, rising to a height of 14,500 feet. Life, God, offers us choices. We may be tempted to go the easy right way and go down where all you got to do is walk down, no challenge. But down there is muddy water. Or you can go this way. Give up the temptation to say, "No, it's too hard. I can't hike that path. I can't make it. I can't do it." But when you get to the top, you've got a view that is magnanimous. Don't give in the temptation to not get up there because it's too hard. I'm with you. I will strengthen you. I will renew you when you get tired. But be strong in the Lord, because I am yours. Temptation is a real issue in all of our lives, in all of society. And God gives us the freedom to choose who we listen to. Who writes what? Whether it recognizes a balanced approach or it's totally leaning the other way, which is all negative. God blesses us when we say, "Choose the written that is a blessing." Amen. May God bless us as we continue that process in His name. A song of response for those who are able, please rise. Join with me in the words of the Apostles' Creed, which is a review of the basics of the faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And we pray. Wondrous giving God, we thank you again for the gift of choice, which you call us to make tough decisions, but to get insight and wisdom when we make our decisions, to ask your help from your written word, from the fellowship of believers. Lord, thank you that we can deal with temptations in ways that are better for us and for all of your people. Lord, in your mercy, Lord, we also know that humanity has fallen. We've all fallen in some dramatic ways and done unjust things to other people at times, even within our own families. But you don't blacklist us. You also see your image in each and every one of us, and so that when we do fall, we can always rise when we recognize what we've done, said, and we ask your forgiveness and claim your grace, your amazing grace in Jesus Christ. Thank you for that process of forgiveness. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord God, we know that the voices are many out there. Some's very strident about the America, Christianity, and churches are not good because of whatever reasons. And then there are other faithful people saying, yeah, we know our churches and our country hasn't always been the best, but it also has a lot of good values and traditions. Help us to see them and continue to build on them like they have. Lord, in that mix and ambiguity, let us come to you time and again and recognize the differences and make better choices by your grace and mercy. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, bless our leaders again to make wise, insightful decisions as they ask and they dialogue with one another for the good of the country. Thank you for synodical leadership that has provided ministry in other parts of the world, Moro Diocese, Tanzania, El Salvador, Reformation, and Milwaukee. Bless those ongoing ministries and are part of them. Lord, in your mercy, hear. And finally, Lord, we know that we all struggle at different times of our life in body, mind, spirit, and relationship. We all know we do, and there are many on our minds. Lord, we recognize all the names that are there, and we give them to you. But we also like to give, right now, those names possibly who we've heard some just before the service from Jen, who are struggling. Hear us as we give you these names that we know of, silently and out loud if desired. Micah. Yes. Yes. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, thank you for your wisdom, your insights, as we continue to give the ones that we care of, particularly today and throughout the week. Bless and bind them to your holy will. In Jesus' strong name, amen. As we come to the table, I say, the Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. our Lord Jesus Christ in the time of betrayal, to embolden his disciples for the future, which was uncertain and scary. He took bread, broke it, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, "Take and eat all of you, for this is my body given for you. Do this as often as you eat it in remembrance of me." Same manner also, Christ took the cup, gave thanks, and said, "Take a drink, all of you, for this cup is a new covenant in my blood, given and shed for forgiveness, given in love. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And we pray the prayer that Christ taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who live. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Amen. All are welcome to the table. Christ is the host. Follow the lead of the ushers. In Christ's name.
Thank you.
Those who are able, please rise. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen and keep you in this life to the next. Amen. I want to walk. God of abundance, with this bread of life, cup of salvation, and your written word, and your living word, Jesus Christ, you have united us with Christ, making us one with all your people. Now send us forth in the power of your Spirit, that we may proclaim your redeeming love to the world, and continue forever in the risen life of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Go in peace. Jesus is with you. Amen. Have a great week in Christ.